you could have somebody literally flying around hovering in this ship as you take aim with the chain gun in the back and lay down cover fire from above. Guys, this could double as a small gunship. And you don't even have to have this. You could have people in the back with a railgun or rocket launchers or grenade launchers. This could act as a dropship. Guys, this is a mini dropship. Okay, so today, guys, is a little gameplay day. I'm gonna record some gameplay here, toss it up on YouTube for you guys to watch as I test out the Nomad. This is really, I'm working on my review for the Nomad right now, but I did want to also upload this for you guys to see the full-on testing process and not just the cuts I take and put in my review. So we're starting off here at Grim Hex because I got stuck by this weird scanning bug where like the ships scan you but they never stop scanning you, so you either are allowed to move and get a crime stat or a fine or just sit there forever. So I decided to move and I got the crime stat, so now here I am. Before we get started though, I do want to give a shout out to my newest patron. Crap, guys, sorry, I got an alert that the 3080 was in stock and it was $1,500, so I'm back. I want to give a shout out to my newest patron, Joe Johnson. Thank you so much for your support, I really appreciate that. Anybody who would like to also support me on Patreon, it really helps me to support my family, make a living doing this, and continue to create awesome content for you guys. It also comes with some perks, like exclusive cinematics, exclusive videos, early videos, exclusive streams, and all that jazz. So if you want to do that, feel free. Link is in the video description, and it's very much appreciated. Now, here is the Nomad. Let's see what this baby can do. Okay, guys, so we are sitting here inside the cockpit of the Nomad. And this is something that I'm actually putting in my review. The look at how technological Consolidated Outland is with their ships. Just seeing, and let me just start by saying I really love these switches. I love how the buttons are not buttons. And I don't like that they're not buttons, but I like how they're switches. You can see if they're on or off very, very clearly, compared to the physical buttons just being switches. These are super obvious as to what is working, what is not. Is that open? Well, it's flipped over, so it must be open, although it's not flipping over, so that works perfectly for me. Anyways, so yes, I love that it is one HUD that goes across the entire screen, or across the entire cockpit. It's really cool looking. It's really technological. It has a very distinct Consolidated Outland feel to it that I feel like no other company really has yet. It's unique. It's a little technologically advanced. It's a little different. It's forward thinking, and it also falls a little bit in line with that idea that you've heard it before, but Consolidated Outland is the Tesla of Star Citizen. And there are a couple other things here that will show that, but that's sort of part of the vibe I'm getting from this. So I really like this part of the cockpit. I think they did a good job with it, and I think if they move forward with working, see, you have Origin with their very fancy holographic projected HUDs that will be floating in the air. The MFDs will be floating in the air, all this really fancy stuff. You have I flew to the wrong place. You have Drake, who will be much more tactile, much more feely. You have Anvil and Aegis, who are much very militaristic and have a very reliable, quality-filled feel to their cockpits. And then you have something like this, which is kind of, it's not in the middle. It's sort of offshoot. It's off left field. And I like that. I don't even know where we jumped to here. I'm pretty sure I said jump me to Hurston. Where'd you take me? Oh, they took me to Hurston L1. That was fast. We got here fairly quickly. Let's continue our journey. Because I don't want to be here. Something has gone horribly wrong. And I can't manual jump either. There we go. Now I can. Just had to utter that magical word, can't. And Star Citizen is there to prove me wrong. So, while we're traveling here, let's go ahead and hop out the sea real quick. Let's take a look at the interior. So CIG has given Consolidated Outland a mishmash bit of a design language. This is really strange here. They really crowded you here with the door. You get out right into the door and it causes some trouble with the sensors. Note also that these doors, even though this is a newer ship than the Star Runner, these doors don't actually have sensors, or at least controllable sensors like the Star Runner does. That kind of leads me to believe that this ship might have been a little bit rushed. It might not have been planned to have come out at this time, and they decided to push it anyways. I'm not sure. But there are unfinished bits to this ship that do not stand up to the standards of what Crusader's normal ships have now. Or rather, sorry, what Star Citizen ships have now. Now, let's take a look at the interior design here. As I said before, it's a very mishmash kind of design. You can see some of the concept art from the Pioneer in here with the orange struts. It has a little bit of a cave feel, a closed down feel with angles pointing downwards, which actually makes the ship feel a little claustrophobic. It also has tons and tons of angles, 30 and 60 degree angles, etchings in the walls. Obviously that orange color is the CO trademark. You're going to see that everywhere in the supports and the struts and the details in the different parts of the interior. And personally, I think it's a really good touch. Crusader has red. Origin has, I guess, a light blue. Drake has a bit of a red as well. And Argo also has an orange. And because of that, that orange color is really, I think, starting to be associated with industry. Even Misk has a little bit of orange in there. And that in itself makes Consolidated Outland feel a little bit industrial in its design language as well. And that goes along with the way these supports are working, and with the way the ship is overall designed. You'll see various etchings around the floor. You'll see some gratings here and there. Really things that aren't necessarily hidden, but are definitely made to fit in with the surroundings. I do really enjoy that there's some nice pleasantries in this living space. You got a cactus over here, a succulent, a plant of some sort. Just breaking things up, adding a little bit of color in a very monochromatic, I guess we could say duochromatic. Is that right? Duochromatic? I don't know. A very two-colored space. Now, looking at this door, you can really see the angular bits that CO is starting to work into their design language. And as we move closer to the door here, you can even see the way in which it animates as it pulls away. It really solidifies that sort of geometric playground that is this ship. Then that is the new CO style. The way that the door folds away kind of reminds me of this old video we had of Xion technology. And I know some people believe that this ship might have originally being a Xion ship. I'm not sure I really subscribe to that, given the hover tech and the design and everything. I don't think that's really true. I think this does still look very CO in its design. And I think the Xion ships are generally more elegant than this is. This is a very this ship is a little behemoth. I like to call it a mini monolith because it has a design that is incredibly, let's see if we can get out of the ship, we cannot. It has a design that is very monolithic. Everything in here is how I would imagine a vault would feel. As I said, it's very downwards facing in its angles. And it's very cave-like. And it just feels like a large space made small, in my opinion. I think that Xion design is more elegant than this. Now in the back section here, you can see again how things aren't necessarily left out. Like if you go back to other ships' designs, like the Drake ships, or even the Crusader ships, you see a lot of pipes, the hoses. You see things that are not necessarily supposed to be left out in the open, in a nice looking refined area that are. Now, Consolidated Outland here seems to have a design that is most definitely not minimal. There's a lot going on here, but it's very clean. Everything is cleaned up. You can't see any of the inner workings of the ship. It's all covered up in geometric shapes that are quite unique and complex. And I would say that's definitely something that sets them apart. There's no other manufacturer that really looks like this yet. And they did a good job of advancing this design for the company while also still incorporating things that you see from the Mustang and from the Pioneer concept art. which is different from, say, Origin, who created their new design language a couple of years ago and had to completely redesign the 300i because they just could not make that work with how the new design of Origin was looking. Something that's kind of similar with RSI as well. The Constellation is suffering from this sort of identity that doesn't really fit with RSI, at least from what I see of things like the Apollo. It looks similar, but it really needs an update, whereas the Mustang is going to be fine. This really feels like the Mustang in its own way. Again, mostly you see this orange color all over the ship. It's definitely something they're going to stick with. Between everything that we've seen from Consolidated Outland, orange is the color to go with, and I like how sparingly they use it to really highlight some of the structural bits of the ship without overdoing it. Now up above here in the middle section, you have components. Not necessarily the most easy access, but convenient still. It's right here. You can pull it out, set it down on the ground, work on it if you need to. There's not really a work desk around here anywhere that you can actually do significant work on it, but definitely enough storage in the back if you'd like to have a replacement. Unfortunately, you will have to go out into space or whatever your surroundings is to get back there. All we have to take us to the cargo hold is this. Not much you can do here. The window that allows you to lower and raise the ramp, besides that, this is all you have to look out into the cargo and make sure everything's good. Kind of makes sense, because in any other ship that carries cargo, you can see that cargo because you're on the ship. But at least this window is here so you don't have to leave the ship in order to see your cargo. Now over here you have your bathroom. Simple, easy. And over here you have more component space. Simple, easy. As you can see, the doors here, once again, are playing with this sort of geometric transformation kind of idea. Happens everywhere that we go. With the bathroom door as well. This sort of four quadrant door design seems to be their thing. This Crusader has this sort of circular thing going on with octagonal doors as well, and CO seems to have this four quadrant open and reveal kind of door design. It's cool. This ship has solidified the design language of the company. It was not there before. The Mustang was a trial, and it was good, but it didn't quite do it. This ship does it, and I know now moving forward what to expect from these ships, and what I should know about the company's design language. In fact, now I can get on with my manufacturer's guide to Consolidated Outland and Crusader. Some nice pleasantries here next to the bed. Some books. A nice little tree there and a glass thingy. Give it a couple pets before you go to sleep or whatever you want to do. Another book, a coffee mug. And a monitor, just in case you want to do some late night engineering. But yeah, this is a very Spartan setup. This is honestly, it's a small ship. It's very easy to get a full idea of what it is. How about we go ahead and head outside real quick? Here we are in orbit over Hurston. And you can see, as I was saying, the outside of the ship definitely has a monolithic vibe to it. It is so incredibly, I don't want to say one-dimensional. Honestly, I don't really know how to describe it. But it's not in any way delicate. I can say that much. It looks like a stone that's been molded to carry things. It's very strong. It's a strong shape. When the landing gear is up, it's also quite sleek. Angular corners. Many large flat surfaces. Very, very normal for a ship from this manufacturer. There are certain angles that make this ship look really ugly. And then there are actually a lot of angles that make it look really nice. The design at first was not something I really vibed with, and then I love it now. I really like it. I love how strong it is. I love how, I hate to say it, but bold in its design it is. This cockpit is incredibly just out there. Look at how thick and almost unrefined it looks sitting on this body. Yet it works. I don't know what it is about this ship, but I really, really like this design. Anyways, let's get back inside and keep on going with our review. Alrighty, so what we're gonna do now is we're actually gonna head to Aberdeen. We're gonna land near one of the outposts out there and spawn a rock. I'm gonna get a rock, I'm gonna put it on this bad boy, and we're gonna do some mining. We're gonna see how easy it is to take the ship, find some minerals, land, get the rock out, do some mining, return and sell them. We're gonna see if we can do that in, 20 minutes? So how about we get on our way? Where is Aberdeen? Ugh, Delamar, you're always so annoying. I think Aberdeen might be on the other side. Let's head over to the other side of the planet to find Aberdeen. Okay. I want to hit an OM marker. Nope, that's not an OM marker. That would be an OM marker. Orbital markers make it a lot easier, especially OM1. It generally takes you to the top of the planet. Makes it easier to jump to wherever you need to go. And there we go. There's Aberdeen. Okay. Now we head to a mining outpost. Looks a little dark over here. Not my favorite. Not my favorite situation. Especially on a moon like Aberdeen where you can't see anything. But we're gonna see if we can get a rock here. If not, we'll jump onto the other side of the moon. This is crazy. I can see a mountain right there in front of me, but I can't actually see it. I can kind of see it. Where are my lights? Okay, so flying in third person now I can see, and you can see very clearly that I was about to hit a mountain. There's my lights. They're just really weak. Let's fly over this mountain, yeah? And where is our landing location? Did we pass it? I think we might have passed it. Yep. Back that way. You see a couple of little lights down there. Looks like that's where we're headed, so let's go in for a landing. Coming in nice and smooth. We're gonna land on the big pad because I'm not a great pilot. I want a little bit extra space. Go ahead and drop our landing gear and settle down nice and easy. This brings up another point to this ship. It hovers. Yes, it doesn't actually touch the ground when it lands. Engines off, and it's still in the air. Beautiful sunset, though. I love the look of Hurston in the distance on Aberdeen. It always looks so amazing. We're gonna get our little mining buggy here. Hopefully it's available to us. It looks like it is on this moon. But I think I may need to call in. Nope, we'll get it. We'll get it straight from the moon here. Okay, so sometimes this happens. It looks like we might not actually be able to get this vehicle. Even though it is available on Aberdeen, it looks like we're not going to be able to get it. It is very disappointing. But it is yet another very common glitch that you get in this game. And trust me, you get a lot of them. Well, that's a huge bummer, guys. We won't be able to do any mining today. But what we will do is we're going to see if we can transport a... Well, I swear I just saw... There it is. A cyclone. In the back of this ship. I know we can do a rock because we did do it. In fact, I'll throw up some quick footage here and you can see the rock is very easily and calmly resting on the Nomad. All you have to do is load it in backwards and then turn the engine off when you get in there. And it's no problem at all. This ship can carry a rock around and do some mining. It's just a matter of how efficient is it? And we won't be able to test that out today, but we are going to see what we can do with the Cyclone. Cyclone is a little buggy. Kind of reminds me of a Warthog, especially this one with the gun on top. Oof. I'm wondering if we're going to have to back this guy on here as well. Or if we could drive straight on. Or if it will even fit. Oh yeah, that should fit. That should fit just fine. But can we just roll straight on there? It'd be a fun little experiment to find out. All right, let's see if this works. We're gonna test it out first by just rolling up on there real quick. And if it starts glitching out on us, then we'll back in. So far, so good. If we can hop out here without falling into the planet or something. Got enough space to just barely get out of here. Can we do it? We might be trapped in here. Is this what defeats us? Music is perfectly fitting. Okay, we're good. Now let's see what happens if we put the ramp up. Oh, and there we go. Okay, all right, settle down. Settle down. Oh, geez. Oh my gosh. Come down, please. I think he's broken. I don't think that music could have been any better for that. But I think we just lost our chance with that immediately. If entering this helps at all. Doesn't seem to... Where is Master Chief? What do you guys say we hop into the ship and see if we can tip this? Oh geez, I threw it. I just threw that thing. It is floating away. I don't believe that's what I wanted. I don't believe that's really gonna help you get in here. Maybe I can catch it? Can I catch this? Make it happen. This is like an action movie. This is Mission Impossible right now. Nope. He's taking me down with him. This guy is on a crash course, and he's taking anybody else down with him if they get in the way. And he's... Oh! Flipped. Now stay like that. No, stop it. Can I pancake him? Ugh. Stay with your wheels on the ground. Okay, that actually kind of looks not like it's like it's not gonna work actually. Okay guys, I spawned another one of these bad boys. This time we're gonna do things a little bit differently. Like I said, we're gonna back this one in. What do you think? Is it gonna work, guys? Do you have faith? If you don't have faith, you better leave this video now, because you're doubting me, and it is putting this negative energy into this attempt. I don't care if this is after the fact. The fact that you are doubting me right now, watching this video, I can feel it here in the past. I can feel it. I need your positivity, guys. Oh, I didn't turn the engines off. I need all the positive energy you can get. Put your hands on the screen. Put your hand on your computer monitor or your TV or your phone, whatever you're watching this on. Place your hand on it and say, "The only good tomato is a dead tomato." Oh, wait, no, that's the wrong one. Say, "Good luck, tomato." Good luck and may Chris Roberts be with you. Here we go. No. Stop it. Settle down. Good. I think it's okay. I think it's gonna be all right. Now. Let's take this somewhere. Okay, so we've left the other moon, quantum traveled, made it into the atmosphere of this second moon, and Cyclone's still good. Grav plates are holding up, everything's in place. But I'm not exactly sure why we're down here. I mean, so one thing is that this definitely proves that this ship can act as a small vehicle transport. This is going to help hugely for events and races like the Daymar Rally. Being able to use this ship to transport your Cyclone wherever it needs to go with a couple people on board, super, super useful. So that's a big testament to the usefulness of this ship. Now I'm going to tell you something else that this ship has that not many other ships do that makes it even more useful than we're already talking. Back here, on the very back, not there now, but it will be in the future, we have a utility mount. That means that you're going to have the capability of putting a scanning array on there, a mining laser, a tractor beam, many different things. Utility mounts are going to be ever expandable as we move further and they add more utilities to this game. Being able to attach those things to the back of this ship opens up your possibilities so much. You're going to be able to, I mean, not only, of course, load your cargo onto this ship very easily with the tractor beam, you're going to be able to use this ship to mine, put those raw organic minerals into the back of the ship, and then take it to a refinery or a refining ship. Better yet, you could use the tractor beam to grab small asteroids, put it in your cargo bay, and ship them over to an Orion that's in nearby who's chomping up on some asteroids. Orions aren't easy to move. It's much easier to bring the small asteroids to it than to move it for every asteroid you need to. Having a swarm of these ships, or even having a few of these ships, is going to be a huge deal in the near future, because worker ships are going to be in high demand. We're going to have a lot of tasks that need to be done that you can't just get your Cutlass to do, or your Constellation to do, or your Carrick to do. You're going to need a small worker ship like this to do it. And I think that this ship has a ton of potential to be one of the main worker ships in the verse, especially in the outer areas, the fireout colonies, the homesteads, the places where there aren't big docks or starports for people to dock into, places where you're going to need to do those last minute shipments, or, you know, because a homestead is only on 30 days of food left, places where you're going to need to fly in something crucial very quickly at a moment's notice, because you're the only one who can. That was a very ugly landing. Luckily, these hover skids, I guess, skid. Okay, so it struggled a little bit with getting out, but we're still here, right? For the first week on the job with this thing, at the very least, you can transport. And that's a start. We're here. We're on a new moon. We're driving around. It's like we never left the ground. This is a big deal to me. This may be the smallest vehicle that can carry a cyclone or a rock. And that's saying something. For a game where people are looking to see how much they can fit into a small area, that is saying something. I'm really happy to see that you can put vehicles into this ship. This is a versatile ship, folks. This is a solid ship. Mining, cargo, transportation, a utility port. Guys, this ship is the real deal. As far as small ships go, this is one of the most useful there is. I will be giving these away for years to come. If you'd like to get into those giveaways, by the way, I drop a lot of ships on my Twitch stream. In fact, I'm currently doing a Mercury Star Runner giveaway. That ends on December 2nd and can allow you to get the amazing new ship for free. But I will also be giving away these Nomads fairly regularly, as well as other ships here and there and sub items. I also do giveaways on my Discord server if you'd like to join that. Linked in the video description. Along with everything else. And by the way, here on this very YouTube channel, I have a giveaway going on at all times, every single month. This month is a 100i. Next month, we'll see. So if you'd like to get in on that as well, that's also in the video description. Now here's something I've always wondered. I want to make it happen. There we go. Alrighty. Here it is. Imagine. Just imagine for a second you have somebody flying you around in this ship. Turn this bad boy on. You could have somebody literally flying around, hovering in this ship as you take aim with the chain gun in the back and lay down cover fire from above. Guys, this could double as a small gunship. And you don't even have to have this. You could have people in the back with a railgun or rocket launchers or grenade launchers. This could act as a dropship. Guys, this is a mini dropship. This is brilliant. This is absolutely brilliant. The usefulness of this ship is just leaking from the seams. I love this. I am such a huge fan of this ship and what it could be used for. The utility mount, wherever it is back here, it's somewhere up here. It's going to make this ship so much more useful. And look at what we can already do with it. So let's go ahead and real quick, I want to see how much Laranite we can transport with this ship. Let's head off to a place where we can buy some. Let's see how much you can make. Oops. Okay, goodbye then. Let's see how much you can make with a full load of Laranite in this ship. I'm already convinced at the usefulness of this ship, but I'd like to see what it can do in terms of cargo transport. So we're coming into one of my favorite places here to buy up Laronite on Ariel. This is a great trading route. If you guys are new to the game, this is a good one to stop by, grab some either Laronite or Titanium, ship it on back to Lorville, which is the main city on the nearby planet, and they'll buy it for a pretty penny. They'll give you a little something for your troubles. Engines off. Let's go ahead and unload the Cyclone and load up the goods. Oh, stop exaggerating. You're okay. You're all right. Oh, 180. That's what I like to see. You'll love to see it. The 180. Alrighty. Let's crash this into the side of the building. Hop on out of here. Oof. Fill her up. 45,000. Ooh, and we couldn't even get all SC. We gotta have to get some titanium. We got some space left over. So another 6,000. Probably about 60,000 UEC worth of Laronite. We just ordered up about 51,000 UEC worth of cargo. We could probably make a 10 to 13,000 UEC of profit on one run. That's not bad. This as your starter ship can easily get you a rental with a bigger ship in a few hours, if that. Alright, we got it loaded up on our cargo bay. We got a thruster with a little bit of an issue up here. Probably ran it too hard, but we're gonna go ahead and chug on through, make it down to Lorville, get some sales on this and see how much money we make. Well, that was pretty. Cargo is still safe in the back, though. That's what really matters, right? Got those grab plates keeping the boxes in check. And honestly, you know, the question comes up, hey, well, how are those boxes staying still? I mean, the same way they stay still in any cargo bay, right? It's not like on the other ships we have the boxes tied down inside. They're all still just sitting on grav plates, but they're not flying around. The main thing I would be worried about here with the cargo on the outside is, can somebody just float in and grab it? Can somebody use a tractor beam to pull it off? Can it get shot and destroyed? Those are the logistics I'm worried about. And probably the type of things you need to worry about if you're flying a ship like this. Coming in for a landing here at the big Lorville. Honestly, it's kind of funny. The Hurston building, I feel, is the closest comparison to the Nomad in terms of feeling, design, and the language it's trying to inspire. It's monolithic, it's big, it's detailed, but it's not. Pretty sure this is me. Of course they close the doors on me, because who doesn't do that at Lorville? They constantly are trying to make it harder to land here. It's actually a little sad how difficult, how hard of a time they're having making spaceports work.
Complete.
Doesn't say.
We're now here in Central Station. This is like Deus Ex Central, in my opinion. It's just honestly a lot of what this place feels like in terms of architecture and colors. But when we get inside, it'll feel a lot more Blade Runner. Very monolithic, what's the word that I've been looking for? I have been brutal. Brutalistic, brutalism, whatever you want to call it. The inside is very stoic, Spartan, almost draconian. I like this area. Wish it was a little more lively. But this is the business district of this city. Generally where you go to do all of your big time purchases, ship weapons, slaves, no, not slaves, but you can also trade and purchase minerals and other resources here. The ship all around the system. This is a center of business for this planet, though. We're gonna head over here into the trading room, where there's a lot of financial information displayed all around. A lot is supposed to be going on in here, at least. People down on the trading floor down there. And we've got our own terminals up here. Big boss up there, standing on his desk again. He's always getting out of hand. He drinks. And, we're gonna see how much we can sell this for. So we spent about, 51,000 UEC buying all this? And it looks like we're getting, 57 back. So we only made a profit of about 6,000 UEC, so it will actually take a little longer to make good money than I thought. That doesn't necessarily bode that well for trading in the Nomad, but it's better than, better than the other starter ships you have access to. So about 6,000 total in profit. Not great. But again, better than the other options, and as cargo becomes more valuable, less valuable, supply and demand starts to pick up, the economy starts to develop, you may find yourself getting better deals in different areas where bigger ships won't be able to necessarily participate so much as the Nomad might. And with that, folks, we're just about done here. Sun's coming up, which means it's time for me to go to bed. I live in the night, operate in the night, do my reviews in the night. In real life though, it's actually getting pretty late here, so I'm gonna go ahead and call it. I just wanna see the sun real quick. But again, I'd like to thank everybody for checking this out. This is kind of something new I'm trying. Some more candid gameplay with a little bit of commentary. Not too much though, some time for you guys to just relax and reflect on the gameplay as a whole with some music in the background. I thought it would be nice. It'd also be a little insight into what I'm doing outside of the more traditional formatted videos to show you guys how I make my videos, how I get my shots, and all that kind of stuff. So if you like this, make sure to give it a thumbs up if you don't mind. Let me know you like it. And also maybe consider mentioning that in the comments, that you enjoyed this. You want to see more gameplay. And this doesn't just go for Star Citizen. Cyberpunk is coming out in a couple weeks, and I'd like to upload that gameplay to YouTube as well for you guys to see. So let me know if you want to see that, particularly Cyberpunk. Let me know if you liked this. Feel free to subscribe if you want to see more. Make sure to hop over to Twitch for my giveaways, and of course the Discord server where we have giveaways, as well as a ton of gamers over there who love to talk and meet up for some game sessions. That'll give you a good group to hang out with as well. But again, guys, I just like to thank you for hanging out, sticking around, checking this out, and I hope to see you in the next one.